Oh no! Welcome back, everybody. We have game number two here between 4C&L and the Power Rangers. 4C&L just managing to take game number one. And we are here now with game number two. Durka, what do you think about Power Rangers' chances?
I think that if they can continue to execute like they did in the middle of that game, you know, 17 to 25 minutes in, where they're just hitting over and over again super hard on the gyro, stopping him farming, you know, contesting the farm spots was pretty much key in that. I don't know how they stopped Bambo from running around being a madman doing his own thing, though, you know, split pushing and TPing onto racks. It's really hard to say. I think laning phase you do have to focus a little more on if there's a greedy strat like that from 4C&L again. Mm-hmm. Because laning phase didn't go well for Power Rangers, and that was where a lot of their strength really did lie.
Yeah.
Queen of Pain against Storm, PL and Dazzle against the Beastmaster really should have won out a little bit more.
I would agree. I think that they can't afford as many mistakes in the early game. Oh. All right. Remake time.
Oh.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. So, apparently there was a remake as soon as I was just like, wait, there's still no bans? Oh, dear. We have problems.
Get ourselves in
our, here. Our passwords, man. Password. What?
Like a 50-character long password.
Yeah, that's going to be a little bit. Sorry, we're working with
17 keyboards.
Yeah. Hence the slight fumbling at our intro. We have a slight slight change in our studio, hopefully allowing us to make much smoother production. But first time using it, it's going to be a little hard. So
we're learning.
Yeah. Plus every single time I changed, we had a ping. So I was like, oh, okay. Our audio isn't straight set up, but it's all good.
Ping.
It's all good. We're gonna iron out these kinks as time goes on. Besides, Dirk and I just flew in today and we're here casting the defense.
I think
we get an A for effort.
Yeah. We were in Cologne, what, 12 hours ago? Less?
Yeah.
8 hours ago?
We were doing the Red Bull Battleground.
Gaming ground.
Gaming ground? Oh, my God.
Well, I've made that mistake so many times.
Yeah, you know, what they had? They had their background, right? Behind the players, they actually had Red Bull Gaming Ground as part of, like, I think it was, like, the website or something. It was, like, redbull.tv or something like that. And every single time I would do my intro, and like, welcome back, everybody, and I would look to that. I would be like, because
sure.
It's not Battleground. It's not Gaming Grounds. There's no S. Gaming ground. That's all it is. So every single time I do my intro, I would peek. I would like, it, and it was decently behind the camera too. So I'd look at the camera and then, gaming ground. Gaming ground. Yeah.
Teleprompter just for you.
That's what I needed.
Printed onto the wall.
Yeah, that's what I needed. Especially in those situations where I was like, I'm not sure what we're doing next. But all right, we're starting the game. We're starting the game, guys.
We're in.
So hopefully, we'll be able to talk about some Dota. Because I love me some Dota, man.
And before remake number... No, they've banned a hero. Went to live.
All right. Perfect. Perfect, perfect, perfect. Okay. A little bit more perfect.
Perfect.
Leshrac.
Radiant and PL. Team pick.
Bounty Hunter.
Bounty first pickup.
What do you think? Lina Earthshaker?
I mean, Gyrocopter's still in the pool, so...
The trouble always is that, like, neither of those heroes does too well against Bounty, but you do have the rest of your draft to kind of even things out.
Yeah. I would say Gyrocopter Earthshaker. Gyrocopter Tusk. Gyrocopter...
Oh, I like Tusk Lina. Like, I really think you want Lina, just the fact that if you give it to Power Rangers, they've got Lina Bounty.
Yeah, that's
and there's
true.
Nothing
that's
that can handle that middle lane.
Yeah, that's probably not an ideal situation to give that one up.
Oh, I like the Tusk. I think that's a good go.
Lina Tusk then?
Yeah.
That'd be a pretty decent opener.
Like with a bounty, you're not really going to pick up Earthshaker, are you? So you still have that option for yourselves later on in the draft?
I mean, you could still make the four position Bounty Hunter and the offlane Earthshaker.
I guess.
It works okay. Because I feel like one of the things that you can do all right is because, like, if the support is keeping his distance against you, the Bounty Hunter comes in from the side for the early harassment. Like, you're able to isolate the the support even more when the bounty hunter goes for that first hit. So you're able to get, I feel like, a lot more damage out on that hero, separating the support from the carry. And that will then allow you to be able to do so much damage that it forces the support back. And then Bounty Hunter continues his roaming mission or whatever he wants to do. And the Earthshaker is able to play a bit more aggressively forward. That is only really works against dual lanes, though. Against a more dedicated offensive tri lane, it doesn't work as well. But I don't think many teams are willing to run as dedicated, like full-on two supports babysitting or carry, because oftentimes you're running carries like Gyrocopter who are kind of self-sufficient naturally anyway.
And they also want to hit that really fast level six timing, you know, like 5.5 minutes in, you want that ulti so you can actually look to TP around a little bit earlier to start off the team fights. But they do go for Lina and Gyro. You know, Gyro is good against the bounty if you've got someone like Earthshaker, Rubick, anyone with a stun, you know, stun, dust, place a sentry, get the rocket barrage down onto bounty, and he does not have a good HP pool at all. Yeah. I've seen him running around at, like, you know, level 8, where a ton of heroes have 900 HP. He still has, you know, 650, 701 or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Don't mind me. I'm just looking at our sub a little bit.
Gyrocopter ghost and just starts waving at it. Radiant
team ban. I have to wave away the spirits, Durka. That's how I work. The Darkseer. Bounty Hunter, Darkseer. That is actually a really dangerous combo for any support. Like, if you don't pay really good attention, and instantly, like, you against this combo, you have to instantly pay attention to once you get that Ion Shell damage. Because if you take just, like, it doesn't even take that long, right? Say you take 50 damage before you notice, and then the Bounty Hunter hits you, has slowed you down with the Orb of Venom. He's running you down even more, getting more right clicks, more on Ion Shell damage. Like, that 50 HP could actually mean so much between you giving away First Blood and not. So I like this combination for Power Rangers. I was a little bit surprised that we didn't have Tusk or Earthshaker picked up at all for either side here, but I agree with all the picks quite heavily. I think that the Darkseer was a great pickup for Power Rangers, and you really can't go wrong with Gyrocopter and Lina. Forward position, mid lane, doesn't really matter. Lina's a great pickup.
Interesting they banned Brood here, even though they've got the Darkseer. So maybe they're really banking on having their safe lane hero stay down on the safe lane. Also, maybe indicative of having someone... Obviously, Bounty Hunter doesn't deal with a Broodmother. He's going to be running around, and you don't have that secondary support to come down and buy sentries is the big thing. And it does put a lot more pressure on that 5-roll hard support. But the Darkseer Iron Shell and Bounty Hunter, it enables him a lot earlier as well. Because a lot of the time with Bounty, you want that level 2, right? You want the Janada, you want the Invis, so you can run around with the Orb of Venom and crit.
Ideally, once you have level 3, you have insane killing power because that level 1 Shuriken is so much damage. But you're right, like level 2, when you have the Janadas, you know, the burst physical damage that you get in from the critical, plus the pretty decent attack speed, or attack movement speed slow rather, combined with the Orb of Venom, like,
you're not going anywhere.
Yeah, you're gonna be so slowed down. You're gonna be taking so much damage. So
if you're an Earthshaker, you've got one Fissure, you know, in the bank. You start off with very limited mana pool. You need to clarity up for a secondary Fissure. You don't really have the means to stop the Bounty Hunter chasing you down. And also, once Darkseer hits level 2, you've got the Surge on Bounty as well. They do really start to rack up the damage and pressure very early on. So 4C&L, it looks like they need some kind of defensive support, you know, whether it be the Dazzle, like Power Rangers had in the previous game, works decently with the Gyrocopter. You grave so you can flat cannon around in the middle of a team fight. It also keeps you alive. He's very good against Darkseer in that defensive dual lane you were mentioning, you know, Gyro plus Dazzle. Yeah. And you can zone out the Darkseer, but then again, it's difficult to play him against a Bounty.
Ooh.
That works. Bane's stat gain is pretty good. He can handle his own against the Bounty. He's got decent move speed.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe a little bit better than the Dazzle, who would need to grave and heal himself to just get away. And then the Nightmare set up into Rocket Barrage is pretty nifty as well.
Yeah. No, I think this is definitely a good support for CNL. Bane's been picked up a lot more recently. I have to say, I really like the Power Rangers third pick Rubick, though. Earthshaker, like, whenever there's an Earthshaker on the enemy team, it's probably always a good idea to have a Rubick if you can, just because Fisher's so good when you have no cast animation. And then you've got Lina, Gyrocopter, they all have great abilities for you to steal as a Rubick as well. So, Storm Spirit and Animage were the bans from 4C&L. We had the Disruptor and Broodmother banned up by PR. We still need both our mid and our carry. I'm presuming we're going to leave our carry for last here just because, well, actually, You can still run offlaner, Shaker, Bane, Lina as your two supports. So you could actually still have your mid open on 4C&L, which makes it a bit difficult for... Because I thought, okay, since it is going to be a mid Lina, then you know you can choose your mid hero with a little bit more liberty here and save your carry for last pick.
Like, if PR want to go for the TA against Lina, they are Radiant side. It's not going to be as effective already. They don't have the sort of great ancient stacking capabilities that Dire side has. You don't have the easy access to the Roche pit. If they do want to go for TA now as the fourth pick, it's still risky, like you're mentioning. So I feel they have to pick their carry in this spot just to see what 4C&L have as their mid.
All right. Well, what carries do we really have left?
I mean, what deals with the gyrocopter?
I mean, I would normally look towards, okay, they're going to go for SF Radiant side as their mid. I mean, I usually really like the Animage for his mobility, but he was taken out.
It's a difficult one.
5 seconds remaining.
Because you still want some additional team fight at this point in time. You want to be able to have something that combos well with the Darkseer. So any carry that's able to bring some sort of AoE to the fold, but like Faceless Void really isn't in the meta. You could run something really aggressive and go for like a Slardar. You could have the Slardar SF combination with the Vacuum and Slithering Crush combo as well. I think you need some sort of aggressive carry like this because you already have Rubick, who's a very like passive support hero, let's say, simply because he doesn't necessarily facilitate kills all the time because he doesn't bring his own set of nukes and killing power. He's more dependent on his allies. SF, who's very much, you know, farm heavy in the first 15 to 25 minutes, going to be focusing on stacks, getting that mech, getting that PKP. And then you have Darkseer, who doesn't necessarily facilitate a whole lot of kills himself either. Now you compare that to like a Clockwork, Toss, Earthshaker, like these sort of heroes are going to bring a lot more kills. So where does the Bounty Hunter get his early track kills? I think it's got to be with a really aggressive carry that is able to do a lot early. Bloodseeker, I guess, wouldn't have actually been a bad choice at all. He does come online relatively early, depending on how you kind of want to build him, but most Bloodseekers will look for kills starting about 15 minutes.
Like, Wraith King would kind of fit power, you know, they've loved Wraith King for a long time.
Yeah.
Clinks wouldn't be too bad, just to give you that range over the Gyrocopter and the Lina, you know, pummel them with the Searing Arrows, and with the Death Pact, you've got a decent amount of HP to sustain through things like Fiend's Grip and maybe even the Laguna Blade.
Mm-hmm.
But I keep looking at Lunar and thinking it's decent here. You know, you've got a couple of auras to put out the Lunar Blessing plus your Shadow Fiend minus armor. It's a really sticky situation though, because Ember Spirit would be like the ideal hero for that early burst power. Flame Guard, Searing Chains, you can fight at, you know, level 7, 8, 9, whatever.
Yeah.
And then if you do get a good lead, you've got a way to actually farm up. You've got track kills potentially there to boost yourself up as well and get your item progression going. But
10 seconds.
Blink,
remaining.
Echo Slam, Fissure, Fiend's Grip, Light Strike Array, Laguna Blade, once the Aghanims is up.
Whoa, that's a sexy bamboo hero. So mid Pycat Lina, Earthshaker Bane, and you're right, Wraith King. I think they were just like kind of holding off on what that last pick was, and Wraith King is going to work completely fine here. As you said, like the early blade mail is really powerful versus Gyrocopter and Lina. You're a hero with a second life, so you don't have to worry about the burst damage necessarily. The weird thing is going to be are they going to be good enough to be able to deal with the Bane Pudge dual lane?
Ooh.
Do you think that's the combination we're seeing here? Because Bounty Hunter is going to roam around, in which case you're left with just a Rubick Wraith King. If Rubick ever out of position, you get a sleep, you get a hook, he's dead. Wraith King is, I think, unlikely to be able to stop that one with his single target stun. Even if he does stun the Pudge and you are able to get the slow away, I think you've already dealt enough damage to kill the Rubick. And once the Rubick is gone, then you put a lot of pressure on the Wraith King. I think the Bounty Hunter is going to have to rotate to that bottom lane relatively early. Not right away. I think you still need to focus on getting your level 2 and really utilize the Darkseer Bounty Hunter combo that is so strong. But
like, that's their strongest lane. Bounty Darkseer up the top is the lane they have to win. I have to win it pretty decently as well. But against Gyro plus potentially Earthshaker, who won't have too much time this time around. If they do run this Bane Pudge off lane, you know, it's definitely a possibility. Then he's going to have to focus a lot on actually laning. But we saw over the weekend, Cupe playing Pudge. He played it, what, with a Spiritbreaker dual lane, and he's also, I know in the past, played it solo off lane.
Mm-hmm.
He focuses very heavily on getting level 3, controlling bot to get the bounty rune if he can.
Uh-huh.
And then basically just trying to rush into Tranquils, Sol Ring, Urn, and then, like, you know, Blink Dagger. You just basically run around trying to hook people. If you can get those hooks onto heroes like the Shadow Fiend early on, he has no way of handling it.
Yeah, an early hook is death for the SF, so... Yeah, this is definitely going to be... The Earthshaker is also a nice combination hero. Unlikely in the laning phase to really be the hero that's going to work with the punch, but kind of going a little bit more into the mid-game, you could very easily see Fishers ensuring that the hook does land. So... Well, what was our pause for? No idea.
Reasons. Yeah. Some reasons.
So, I guess in the meantime.
Oh, blue is disconnected. Just your cat's not here.
Yeah. He's just gone from the face of the earth, I guess. In the meantime. Oh, I keep hitting the wrong enter button. Hello. Two keyboards. My mind is just so broken right now. Hello.
We've got a good week, though. We've got a ton of stuff to actually get done. Buttons!
Hey! Take away that overlay. There we go. Anyway, so... Oh. I was just about to get into a whole entire discussion. Right as I do that, Cheshire Cat comes back. But we can at least start the discussion. The early aggressiveness. Do you need the quick blade mail on Wraith King, or do you think the Blink Dagger is going to facilitate a lot more for them?
I am a big, big fan of the slow and steady build on Wraith King.
Mm-hmm.
Treads, drums, and then decide where you go with the blade mail or the blink. I don't think Midas really has a place anymore on the Wraith King. You know, we used to see that a bunch just to try and get yourself built up.
Right.
For the, you know, the mid-game fight, things like that. Armlet here, do you think that's going to be worthwhile at all for the Wraith King? You know, armlet toggling through rot, flat cannon, rocket barrage, maybe a dragon slave thrown out. It could still work. It tanks him up a little bit, gives him that extra bit of damage and attack speed. But I really think that the sort of incremental build-up with treads, drums, allows you to take Taos a lot faster as well. The attack speed's great up on him.
Well, an early pickoff on Jackal, I think, is exactly the way 4C&L want to start things off. Great Fisher block, Jackal knows he's dead. He doesn't even try and eat through that tree, yeah. So he just gives up, essentially. And first blood. Going to 4C&L. They're going to quickly head over, take control of the bottom bounty rune. Or do they battle it out for top? Knowing that there's no one bottom right now, they could leave the Pudge bottom lane and they could still have a full 4v4 at the top lane and maybe get both bounty runes. J4 is going to scout this out, though. They do have dust, so we can't really get early damage out from the Ion Shell. Start things off, they do see Swift Ending trying to come in. Double Ion Shell is dishing out a lot of damage. Double Raises gets laid out as well. Swift Ending is actually going to be brought pretty low, but a great Fisher. Pycat, though, in some serious trouble, gets hit by another Raise, and the Ion Shell will take him out. And that will be a winning fight for Power Rangers, though that Bounty Rune, no, it was picked up by Dichira. He was able to get it. Great decision-making from Dichira, especially there. Going for the level 1 raise that was critical for them being able to win that engagement. He'd hit all three of those raises.
Still, Pycat isn't that far behind. AT experience, something along those lines. Mm-hmm. The bottle, though, is going to come out a little bit faster for Dichira, as in right now, because he went for that full-on rush. A couple of branches, a couple of pool tangos. And J4, it looks like, is actually sticking around middle lane. Our observable is getting placed left and right here, and Pycat even given a secondary one.
Yeah, just to make sure that he is able to take away at least one of J4's counter wards. J4 revealing himself now, does get some damage out. Pycat, not sure if he just doesn't want to show the fact that he's got that counter ward and saw the bounty hunter coming. Then again, once you force out, if you can, if he kills your counter ward and then you kill his, you'll be able to use the tango to eat it, and Jackal, that'll be a lot of regen for him.
Dead? They've got the Fisher here from EGM.
But the hook is still able to land, and Jackal just barely survives. 30 HP is all that he lives on.
But that's his lane ruined completely. One death already. They've got a pretty good deep observer ward here watching for the pull, so Big Num is never safe either. And it's not the Bane Pudge lane, it's the Earthshaker Pudge lane.
Yeah, I guess the Bane actually makes a lot more sense versus the Darkseer. Better controlling factor. And the Earthshaker Pudge still works just fine, as we have very clearly seen.
Oh, Bane.
And does take some damage, has the dust. J4 will be revealed, and Rocket Barrage time. J4 is dead. Cashing out.
Pretty simple little takedown there.
Yeah, not much really the Darkseer could do. If he ran over and maybe gave Surge, that could be a potential play. Oh, Jackal gets caught again. 60 Bambo tossed back, though. Jackal will survive, but he is constantly being kept such low HP. His tankos. Maybe he should have brought a health potion instead, because as it stands, his health, his tankos are not healing him up fast enough for him to be able to allow to go back in lane and get CS.
He has 4 last hits while the Pudge has 7. And they're pulling the lane back to this tier 1 tower, where it's going to be super easy for Bambo to line up a hook once again. EGM has really made this lane work, though. Controlling bot rune, which is now a bounty being spawned up, and they're hunting for him. J4, like you mentioned, has actually moved down to this bottom lane to try and control it up, because they need to secure farm on this Wraith King. Darkseer is up to level 3, so he's, you know, he's okay up at top. He's got his Sol Ring coming in, yeah, over on the Courier.
Still going to be a rough lane, I think, for the Darkseer. Just because the early levels on Saxka, you have the level 2 Brain Sap, which is such a huge amount of burst damage, and even if they don't have a controlling factor for his Surge, because most of the time you're going to be slept, Gyrocopter comes in, sets up the Rocket Barrage, and then he searches away, they may still have the burst damage necessary to get the kill. Bottom lane, 60 Bambo does die. J4, his rotation does work out, but Dichiron blocked out in the middle lane by EGM and gets a kill for Pycat. Big plays all around the map, even with 60 Bambo dying as the offlane Pudge. Doesn't really matter too much if you can get an SF kill in the process.
And Bounty Hunter is now in the role that we often see Earthshaker in, having to move from lane to lane to sort of balance out the sort of, you know, aggression equilibrium or whatever you want to call it, where there's these constant pushes forward from the Pudge. There's the middle lane, the Lina's harassing, spamming at Dragon Slave.
Mm-hmm.
But Bounty Hunter doesn't have the toolkit to deal with this. He can't set up ganks from for the rest of his team with a good Fisher. He has to be up there in the middle of the fight almost, you know, melee range with the Lina. And with the Sentry Wards down, he can't really help the Shadow Fiend mid. There's no one that can move middle lane to give Dichira an easier time.
J4, the hook misses. 60 Bambo. He knew he had to get some rot damage out in order to finish him off with the hook. But that doesn't work out. 60 Bambo miss out on the kill. 2-3 now, 4.5 minutes in. SF does have a little bit of stacking. Dichira's not doing bad when it comes to CS, staying slightly ahead of the Lina despite already dying one time to the rotation out from EGM. They do have an Invis rune on Pycat right now, and they're going to try and pick him off again. Pycat rotates over.
Oh, the stack.
He sees the stack, but he can't really clear it through. I think he's checking if the SF was stacking it at the 5-minute marker, but that wasn't the case. Fisher laid out. Dichira sitting on the hard left side, leading with the nuke. Light Strike Array doesn't land, though. Dichira will be able to get out. EGM had already thrown out the Fisher. 60 Bambo. Hook. Oh, he snags him anyway. Dichira ran back into it. He dodged it at first and then ran forward again. And 60 Bambo, 1-1-1 now. That was a huge kill for him as an offlaner to be able to achieve that. Big win for 4C&L.
At level, it is level 4.
Level 5 Pudge now? Insane.
Like, no other hero can do that, right, from the offlane. Another checker can come and Fisher. Like, my brain is just so hooked by the Pudge.
Tusk level maybe? 2, I think, has probably the same kind of killing potential, and it's a little bit easier, but if you land the hook, it's better than Snowball Ice Shards, I think, ever could be.
The displacement you get from it is ridiculous, because it not only gives you the opening to, you know, lay your stuns down onto the target, but also drags them away from any potential recovery from teammates.
60 Bambo. A fishing hook there just to see if the SF was rotating around for the 6-minute rune, but he's clearing through his rather small stack. I believe this is only a 3 stack. So with the killing power, they are giving some room to Jackal finally, who picks up his level 6, so that they can no longer put pressure on the Wraith King, at least not with Pudge and Earthshaker. So they are going to focus a lot more attention to Dishira here in the middle lane.
Good observer ward, though. Even though it's, you know, pretty close to this tier 1 tower, they're getting that vision of the movement across, and it's also pretty much out of D ward range. But yeah, it's just outside of the sentry range, but also, you know, sometimes you see the observer wards up here, and it's sentries get placed across that line, kind of. It's not going to get scattered out by them.
Sexy Bamboo, though, the hook comes in once again, and Dichira is going to be run down by the Pudge. Nothing he can really do. Oh, maybe the bottle, and the shuriken slow down. Janata turns around and gets the kill.
No way.
Oh, Sexy Bamboo, he thought that was going to be a guaranteed one, but the bottle through the rot as well.
Okay.
Bounty Hunter gets deleted. Pycat not messing around.
Okay, Bounty. A little too big for his boots there. And they get the damage on this tier 1 tower in the middle. I think Lina is pretty underrated when it comes to this as well. If she does get the kill at mid lane or forces her her counterpart to actually retreat and go back to Fountain, she can dish out a ton of damage to tower with her fiery soul all top.
Yeah, it's just your cat's done for. Call down surrounds the Darkseer pretty easily. And everyone will be able to escape. There's no rotations in.
It's almost like a Dragon Knight. She doesn't have that dragon form. She doesn't rely really on cooldowns to get it set up, but the attack speed you get from Fire Soul is ridiculously good at taking down towers. I mean, what does she have? 5 or 6 seconds? And she takes it down from 90% to half.
Pretty impressive. The free Hyperstone Fiery Soul. Level 5 now picked up for the Darkseer. But still, his lane is... He's not going to be able to put that much pressure on the Gyrocopter, especially after being shut down early on. They really need a kill in this middle lane. The EGM actually takes a serious amount of damage. J4 coming in will not be able to get the shuriken to finish him off.
Putka. Looking straight into Yule Scepter.
All right, it's a hook for a creep that gets him his level 6. That's actually the first time that I've ever seen Pudge legitimately hook a creep, and it makes a ton of sense.
That's the first time you've seen it.
I mean, what other times do you really, like, legitimately need that 1 CS off of a hook? Oh, telekinesis, push back. All right, that'll be it. Big Num gonna try and run himself away. Rocket Barrage will still be able to get the kill. Meanwhile, in the middle lane, Lina actually managed to pick up the kill on the Bounty Hunter. Once again, Jackal's rotation is a bit too late to stop Swift Ending.
He TP's top and he can't farm here, so he has to walk back down to bottom lane almost.
And Sexy Bamboo takes the opportunity with the Wraith King out of lane. He'll freely get CS, no hook required.
Is he gonna go jungle?
All right.
He's scared of that bottom lane. Smoked up is Sexy Bamboo. On the hunt once again, Dichira with Jackal. They're both in the jungle, but yeah, that reincarnation is up, and Bambo really can't do anything about that. Even with Pycat nearly having the Yule Scepter, Wraith King's still, you know, a difficult target that can kill him once, but killing him twice is always going to be difficult.
Yeah. Sexy Bambo runs into Jackal now. He will be able to escape just fine. At least should be. Cheshire Cat. Yeah, Lightstrike Gray lands Jackal. He's not going to be able to catch up. His farm seems a bit slowed down, though. A bit. 3,400 net worth compared to the 5k on the Gyrocopter.
They need Bounty to get level 6. He's hit level 5. Mm-hmm. He needs to be given a solo lane. But which lane do you give him? Do you try and just put Iron Shell on him and let him farm the jungle for a little while? Because he needs the XP, not the gold, really, so much. But Jackal needs farm. Dichira needs a ton right now. As he's sitting at, what, 4.5k net worth? He's going straight into S and Y, in fact. But Lina already has that Yule Scepter. Even if you do tank up, you're still going to get hit by that combo of Yules into stun.
Yeah, they're really going to need that mech and a decent timing for the Darkseer, but he's been shut out pretty heavily. Soxka, he does see J4 here, and he's actually got Fiend's Grip. He's just going to straight up Fiend's Grip, and he will be stunned up. Pudge Hook to be able to save the Bane in time. And they will not be able to... Oh, maybe they can go for something here. Nice two-man Fisher. Brain Sap, though, isn't up for the Bane. And now Jackal tries to threaten him, but Fissure's a bit too much. But look what's happening on the side here. Piecat's ready to go, and he has Laguna Blade. This could be multiple kills if he's able to play correctly. No, but the Fiend's Grip stolen by Big Num's going to be able to grab him. Hook, actually, he's going to be able to get the return kill, but Piecat is still very much dead. The ultimate goes down, gets some of that damage reduction now on 4C&L. Still going to look to chase him down. Jackal with the surge will be able to catch up to Sexy Bamboo, and that's a great target if they can actually get the kill, which they will. Sleep now getting laid out. Fissure also blocking them up. Call down for the side. Gyrocopter's going to try and go big here, but Dichira, he's bigger. The strength-based build of Sage first allows him to easily be able to tank up all that damage. Swift Ending still looking for more here, but J4, he might know we need the right click. He couldn't get the Janata hit in to be able to slow him down for Dichira to get another raise. So as it is, things will return back to normal. Dichira's build actually played out really nicely there. Strength treads and the two different strength items of Sage. He just allowed him to tank up all that rocket barrage damage. It felt like Gyrocopter was tickling him.
Yeah, the rest of his team backed up as well. The good Fissure out from EGM. You know, it meant the Radiant couldn't chase, but it also meant that the Dire couldn't re-engage. They couldn't get back up onto the high ground to help the Gyro if they wanted to. I'm just wondering if the Radiant's bounty there was really scared of losing his own attack. Life and missing out on level 6 because he's just hit it with the final creep that died over in his own jungle. He's got that track available.
Oh, Jackal, he doesn't have enough mana here. He's going to need to soak up some spells and still get off his magic wand. Maybe, oh, never mind. Intelligent Shreds, he's going to be okay. So I didn't actually see that one, but still, Shishu can't get stunned up. Light Strike Array, Laguna Blade, couple more right clicks, and he will be able to get the kill to Dragon Slave in the end. Meanwhile, Jackal's still stuck in the trees, body blocked out by EGM, will be able to get, oh, never mind, that was actually a nightmare. I thought EGM almost died there. Meanwhile, farther down, 6E Bamboo, actually with the dust, manages to run down J4's Bounty Hunter. This is so, so very bad for Power Rangers. It's 4CL taking the lead here quite heftily, 5-13 at 13 minutes in, and Sexy Bamboo's Pudge has been a part of 5 kills already. He's going to be a beast once he starts getting those levels of Flesh Heap, which he will at this rate quite quickly.
And the Shadow Fiend is going back for mech now. So even if they wanted to fight early on, they're not going to have that mech, the docks here. Wait, what? Shadow Fiend bought a buckler after Sand, right?
Yeah.
But the docks here has chainmail headdress.
I don't know, man. I don't know.
Maybe they feel like the Doxier is not going to be able to get any kind of farm priority, and you know he's going to be shut down before he gets that mech, and they need it desperately.
Yeah.
Need to be able to keep these heroes alive, and it's basically just enabling you to get more tracks out and maybe continue the fight so you can get a couple more kills to try and boost up your gold income.
Yeah, because I think originally the plan was mech Darkseer, and then you have SNY, SF. Decent stat focus, especially if the mech is nearby. You'll survive through the combination of the Lina, and then you're able to go like an early BKB on the SF. And that gives you a ton of battling power against a team that is so heavily magic focused in the first 25 minutes.
EGM, Blink Dagger is not far away. 1600 gold. He's got his arcane boots as well. Piecat, though, you know, treads your scepter. It feels like it's much later in the game than it really is. You know, 15 minutes in, and you're already looking at a 7.4k net worth Lina. Doing very well for herself, but it's the disparity between the, you know, the supports of the Dire and the Radiant. Earthshaker is ahead of the Darkseer in terms of net worth. The Darkseer has very little to his name. And the Rubick is down there. He's got Tranquil Boots and Observer Wards. Sure enough, he's the hard five. But they have yet to get a track kill. They have yet to actually make this bounty hunter pick worth it. He's been shut down from lane to lane. He hasn't really made the impact on the game that they would have liked. Maybe now with the Blade Mail, they can try and run the Wraith King in, but he does not have Reincarnation. So that's 100 seconds where 4C&L get free farming time for the Gyro. Lina gets to, you know, start flying up her Aghanim Scepter, which is really getting closer and closer. And 4C&L can go and look for other targets on the map.
They're going to go for the Fissure Hook here. And if they land it, the Rock Barrage is there as well. Oh. Even with the Blade Mail defense, there's no way Jackal survives. 6E Bamboo even coming in from the side. Great Fissure block. Light Strike Array easily landing. Jackal's dead. Pudge not even needed.
He's waiting for TPs in here, it looks like. But there's going to be no one.
Yeah, usually there's going to be some sort of TP rotation around this area, but as it stands, they'd rather just trade off Tier 2 for Tier 1 with their Wraith King dead.
any little Dire's bit they can get. I'm in search for scraps here on the map, but Radiant tier 1 at top, not really fortified. Objectively a good tower. Based Radiant's on, you know, map position, doesn't really do anything for either team. But it's gold lying in the pockets of the Radiant. Radiant's something. But with fallen. The tier 1 and tier 2, the Dire get down at bottom lane, Earthshaker finally gets that Blink Dagger. Dire's even quicker than J4's one last game. He had, what, 17 and a half minutes in, a Blink Dagger up on that Earthshaker. Now we've got a 16 and a half minutes, 1 minute faster even.
Yeah. Pretty insane. The roaming Earthshaker doing so much work in both games. 006. Pudge Tranquil Boots, and looks to be going perhaps an early Glimmer Cape. Bignum will be able to get the ward kill here, so controlling the map and freeing up more space for Dichira to be able to safely farm, but as things stand, controlling the map is going to be least of their worries when this Aegis is picked up by the Gyrocopter.
Okay, I think I figured out Dark's here. He's opening a thrift shop. He's going to open up like a charity shop.
Jesus.
Honestly, it's just like, I think one of the most, I don't know, not stat efficient, but
frenetic,
know, efficient
schizophrenic.
That doesn't build into anything. Oh, what do you call it? Kleptomaniac. He's a kleptomaniac.
Uh-huh. Okay.
He's just picking up random stuff and like, yep, this goes in my pocket. I'm going to take one of these as well.
I'm guessing he's going pipe.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
So the Ring of Health and Cloak will build into the Hood of Defiance and then obviously need the headdress, but certainly not a build. Oh, okay, Sasuke came forward to try and get Dust, but that's just fail on fail, compound failure here, but they should still be able to get out. It looks like Sasa will be able to try. Oh no, he goes through the brains out of the Blade Mail, does out the damage first. So he actually dies. Jackal's going to be going potentially down here. AGM jumps in. Echo Slam laid out. Dichirado still plenty tanky. Will be able to turn around. And Jackal now with the slow on his swift ending. 4C&L compound failure is right. That just was miscommunication. And it looks like they're going to lose three here. Pycat, is he going to try and go back in? Swift ending is going to be stunned up again. There's no way he can save him. Oh, Rubick even with just the style points, taking the Fiend's Grip once again. That's a mega kill streak fed to the SF. Dichira is huge now, 3K gold, and he hasn't even taken this middle tower.
I don't know what Lina and Pudge are doing. They're kind of running around. I think they were chasing the bounty hunter up to the north, but they really couldn't catch him. They weren't part of the fight. They could, you know, you could maybe have gone for a hook back on the gyro to drag him up to safety, maybe turn things back around on the high ground with a good lifestrike array.
Well, there's a hasted Pudge. So that'll certainly turn things around for them. They're going to go for the SNY and the Ogre Club, so SF won't lose that much.
Yeah, he buys out. No gold wasted there by the Shadow Fiend.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
So it is going to be the Hood of Defiance coming in soon for the Darkseer. Pipe, rather inefficient item right now, given its gold cost. Most pro players really do not like the item, but there is obviously a majority of magic damage on 4C&L. It wouldn't be a bad item.
It's very reminiscent of the old school Darkseer where you'd need pipe and mech to break high ground and
yeah,
just run yourself through into the team fight. But Jackal, he's got 2k gold. He could still go for that Blink Dagger to give them a little more initiation. Because right now they're really relying on J4's tracks, the Shadow Fiend, to bait the enemy team into an initiation, which 4C&L have kind of given them a couple of times now. The Shadow Fiend jumping up ahead of the Gyrocopter in terms of net worth, but even with the SNY, you've still got no BKB. You still have to deal with that level 2 Laguna Blade, the cooldown, the Rocket Barrage.
Oh! Pick off here on J4, ran into range of the counter ward, it looks like.
They're gonna go for Jackal.
And a hook as well. Jackal's gonna be pulled back. He does not have reincarnation, and he is done for. So just as swiftly as Power Rangers found an opening and got a huge win for themselves, defending their tier 2 tower, 4C&L get the pickoff in the bottom river, and now this one, 2 kills right in front of the tier 2 tower, which should be able to bring back the lead they had before.
Darkseid does not have wall yet. I just realized he's level 9.
Ouch.
Radiant's middle tower
That's
has fallen.
Super unfortunate.
I mean, they don't really have that much to combo with a vacuum. I understand, like, vacuum's still an amazing spell, even if you don't have it, but I would think it would be worth going a level of wall at this point.
Yeah. Like, especially for situations like this, where they're pushing high ground, and, okay, they don't have someone actually going up the steps and on top of the ramp, blink forward.
Oh, Jackal actually immediately gets stunned up. That's going to allow the team to be able to get some distance here, but they do have the track movement speed, turn around, call down, gets laid out, ditch it raw, trying to go, and still man up, as Jackal's leading the way on that one, wants to be able to die and get a really good slow off. Lightstrike Array buys him some time. Pycat, though, will end up getting slowed down by that one. Now he's going to be the one chased up. Sasha, though, controlling some of this. Pudge actually managed to pull back J4, gets that quick kill, and Dichira not actually able to chase down Pycat at all, it looks like. Couple more right clicks. Finally, he does get the kill. Started backing up, but now finally able to finish off that Lina. Still, though, the missile will be able to chase him. Gets the small stuns, pull back vacuum, and there goes Swift Ending as well. A great fight there for Power Rangers, picking up three different track kills, it looked like.
No Blink Echo from EGM. Couldn't find the opening. It's not quite level 11 yet. I mean, that fight started okay for 4C&L. They got initiated on. The jump from the Wraith King was really good. Then they bailed themselves out. They managed to allow Pycat to escape. But that moment where Pycat turns to fight the Shadow Fiend.
Yeah.
Seemed like he underestimated the right click damage there from, you know, the 200 per hit SF. Hitting like an absolute freight train, and he got three hit down pretty much, even with the urn starting to tick him back up for the HP.
Yeah, even I think perhaps a bit more importantly is just the high amount of HP on an SF when he goes for this kind of build. He's at 1700 when he has strength treads on. If you look at the Lina's combo right now, it doesn't even come close to hitting that.
And you can't really kill the Wraith King. You could see that when he popped his blade mail, they wanted to hook, they wanted to brain sap and rocket barrage, but even Pycat lifted the arms to the animation on the Laguna Blade and canceled it out, because you don't want to Laguna Blade into blade mail initially, but B, you don't want to be Laguna Blading a Wraith King who's already on a third of his HP, and then he's going to slow you down and come back to life. Because it's not just the fact that he has a secondary life and can then blink forward aggressively with the Wraith Fire Blast, but he also slows your retreat. And 4CL are very positional based. Power Rangers, they can surge forward, blink aggressively. 4CL, they need the hit first. They need the hook, they need a blink echo. They desperately need to get the positional advantage initially to get a fight that they really want to take.
Oh, you know what I thought about? They will still have mech on the Darksteer because he eventually goes guarding Greaves, no matter what.
Okay.
It's really weird, really inefficient, but you still have to go the mech on the Darksteer eventually, even if you have... Because Dichiral will eventually sell his mech, and then you have Guardian Greaves on the Darksteer to make up for that.
Yeah, a little bit later on. He just finished off the chainmail into a medallion. And I guess he's going Solar Crest to put onto the Shadow Fiend. It's always a great item if you do eventually get up to, you know... Well, taking Tier 2s, going to take Roshan, obviously, but if you do get up to high ground... To push into tier 3s, putting Solar Crest onto a Shadow Fiend is like the best thing ever. Even the Wraith King.
Yeah, I think the Guardian Greaves obviously is much more like a 45-minute sort of like item. So he's definitely not... Like, I would say probably... I was expecting Blink Dagger as his next item. But I suppose the Medallion does make good use of the Chainmail that I already picked up.
Yeah, once he's like, right, I've got no slots, I've still got Arcane's Boots of Travel I could go for, but Greaves is going to be that, that little sort of fight tipper that gives them the extra bit. Bane.
Four staff now for the Bounty Hunter, not a Blink Dagger. They go for the push now at this tier 2 in the top lane. They're not actually going to be trading really anything for it. 4C&L just taking over their jungle, but that's okay. 4C&L perhaps a little bit skittish there from losing that last fight. Waiting on Roshan, which will be up in 5 seconds.
Dire's top tower has fallen.
Where are these two heading off to? EGM and Bambo just smoked themselves up in the Dire jungle. In the Radiant jungle, even.
I think they presume somebody's going to TP back and defend, but...
Radiant's bottom tower.
As it stands, Radiant's side not going for just yet.
Oh no, you're on the low ground.
This is not great. He's already going to be stunned up. No opportunity to get off his BKB before a majority of the damage gets laid in. And now the Bane's going to go down as well. And these three other heroes who were smoked up now have to try and go for a quick pickoff, I think. Sexy Bambo. Oh my god, if he gets Dichira here. No, they're going to go for Big Num instead. That's okay. Free kill there.
Well.
Just imagine, though, if he threw the hook in and snatched Ichira and they managed to burst him down, that actually probably would have halted them being able to do Roshan.
Yeah, also the fact they've got Earth Shaker there for these bottlenecks when they come up to try and engage back into them, that Echo Slam could really rip them apart. So Jackal, this build, you know, Blade Mail after Treads and Wand, then into the Blink and now an Armlet. He's going for quite an unconventional actual progression here. No drums, no BKB just yet. What do you reckon he goes for next? Oh, man.
Nice snatch there.
No reveal.
Oh, but PyCat actually trying to go for the blind pickoff on the Bounty Hunter will be caught in the process. Shuriken comes in from the side, bounced off of Sexy Bamboo's squishy body.
And here are the track kills starting to rack up. But yeah, what do you think Wraith King actually goes for next? An AC? Or do you want to go the BKB now so you can... He never feels threatened. It's the scary thing.
Mm-hmm. I think with the Blade Mail and the Armlet, I think you have enough to be able to threaten the enemy team that you're not going to be gone on yourself. So I think AC is probably the best way to build here, and then you can go into a heavy damage build. Yeah, and go straight for the Abyssal, because then you have the attack speed to facilitate the bashes, as well as then an instant blink stun from Abyssal that will be able to go through the BKB of the Gyrocopter. Solar Crest now finished up for Doxia. And level 16 is coming in for Jackal pretty soon. So a lot of ground has been lost for 4C&L, who are once upon a time a 7,500 gold lead ahead. But now it's Power Rangers, who have taken the lead the first time in the last 2 minutes all game long. 2,500 gold lead for them right now, 4,000 experience, and looks like just about to jump a little bit farther ahead now with this tier 2 tower gonna fall.
Bamboo couldn't get the hook there. He was tracked up, of course, so Power Rangers saw it coming. But Gyro, split pushing away. His BKB still at 9 seconds. He hasn't really been forced to use that too often, but the force is coming. He's gonna breach high ground here. Oh, did you rush
nice
on the outside of that
block off? But still, it's.
Yes, Blink.
It's an SF with 1900 gold, a Blink Dagger, and an Aegis.
And Mech BKB.
Oh, the jump straight onto PyCat. They're gonna try and control him. Good Force Staff and Nightmare. The ultimate goes off, actually dodged there by the Yule Scepter. And the Glimmer Cape as well, keeping PyCat very much alive. Now they're just pulling this team fight farther and farther back. Jackal dies and gets a good reincarnation, slowing down 5, but it's still a bit too late. EGM with a great Echo Slam, stalling up this fight even more of the vacuum, and the wall gets laid out. 4C&L now just playing around the fountain as best as possible, knowing that Power Rangers have completely overextended themselves.
Bring the Nightmare
Beans back. Beans Grip, J4, he's definitely dead. How many more can they get? Bignum misses out on that one, still has a Fissure though. And will be able to buy some time for his team. Yule Scepter, Fissure gets laid out just in time. Jackal's actually going for Swift Ending, won't be able to finish off. Blade Mail damage, doing so much work though. Telekinesis pullback, PyCat trying to get that kill on Bignum, not quite enough. Dichira though will feed away his Aegis, it looks like. Trying to go for the kill, Swift Ending, he gets it too. Jackal on the front lines, they're still going for PyCat. He has to run through the wall, will be able to escape, but still. 4C&L played that fight so well, but Power Rangers were just too big. They pulled them back all the way back to the tier 4 towers, but PR just kept committing more and more to that fight and end up winning it still. There goes the Wraith King, finally able to take him out. Pull back though, telekinesis over the Fissure Wall. Not quite there. Cheshire Cat will go down as well because of that one. Great block off for EGM that actually secures their tier 3 tower, does stay alive.
And this is still with Shadow Fiend having Aegis. That was one of the more, I don't know, comical fights I've seen in a long time, where it felt Power Rangers dive too deep. They still got the vacuum wall under 3 people, and then, you know, the fight went back and forth a hell of a lot. 4C&L played it well. They dragged the Wraith King back into a position where he couldn't really battle it out with the rest of his team in a good spot to back him up well enough.
Yeah.
And then they went back in again when Reincarnation was down, got the kill on him. But I'm pretty sure Power Rangers, their plan there was dive in, get kills, consolidate our lead, take tier 3, and we spend Reincarnation and Aegis. They didn't really expect, maybe they thought there's obviously a threat or a risk that multiple heroes are going to die there. But they wanted, obviously, Aegis and Reincarnation to be popped.
Yeah.
And then, okay, we've used these two commodities to bring down 4 or 5 heroes. And then tier 3. But that's just not the way it went. 4C&L targeted the right heroes and...
Yeah. Really you could say that fight went very well for 4C&L, but... I've got an item that I really want to talk about here.
Yeah.
Lotus Orb on the Lina over Aghanim Scepter. I can understand that the pure damage does not have quite the same appeal because you do not have a squishy BKB hero. Like, for example, Gyrocopter is early. Most SFs, the way they build, are quite susceptible to that. But this SF-specific build, early S and Y, mech, and BKB actually allows him to be decently tanky and survive through that combo. Lotus Orb makes a certain amount of sense, but is it really the item for your two position?
I honestly don't know.
EGM's dead, so.
Blink okay? No, he can't blink away from this, can he?
No. It gets rid of track.
Yep.
You'll be able to turn around the Wraith King stun. That's pretty important, I think. I think that's hugely important because Pycat's going to be the target of that every single time. So, essentially, like, you're both being stunned at the same time, and you're both being slowed the same amount, so Lina will always stay ahead of Jackal in that regard.
But what's the reason of going Lotus instead of BKB?
I'm not sure about that. The thing for me is, oh! Hook, jump in, immediately Pipe gets laid out, Fisher and the ultimate, oh, and the vacuum! Get you raw, let's lose big time, Pycat! He managed to get the Bloodstone denied there, but the fight already quite heavily lost, and they're going to be forcing in some buybacks if they want a hope of being able to defend this one. Big Dumb gets caught! Nice hook there from Big... Oh, never mind, Jackal's actually going to come in. I thought for a second that was just going to be one-off pickoff. Looks like Dichiron will be able to get back here. Doesn't have that Aegis anymore. Yule Scepter dodge. Jackal being kited around. They're not going to be able to finish off these racks. In fact, oh, there's the Echo Slam from EGM. Once again, 4C&L are going to be able to hold Jackal. I think it's going to be forced back. In fact, no, he realizes there's no way out of this one, so he just tries to go for the quick kill, but that's not going to happen. Again, Power Rangers seem to have such an advantage going into that fight, but again, just kind of get kited around mostly because of 6E Mambo's hooks and then the great EGM Fishers that always seem to come in from the side. And again, no objective really taken. The tier 3 dies, but the melee and range rack still alive.
Even with almost insta kill on three heroes there, the Blink Requiem Vacuum combo was perfect, immaculate execution from Power Rangers. But the suicide deny from Pycat, the fact he has Bloodstone, allowed him to get back into the fight. Laguna Blade, spam out Dragon Slave, and his Light Strike Array, and Lotus Orb, even if it doesn't debuff something, even if it doesn't, you know, bounce something back like the Wraith Fire Blast, I really like the item choice now. Just seeing it in that one sort of 30-second period, the deterrent it gives. The fact you put it on the gyro, you put it on someone, and no longer are they a target for the continual aggression, the blinking forward time after time, because that's what PR want. They want to keep on going. They've shown that they like to jump on a target, kill him, then blink again. Blink again. Just keep on going from, you know, target to target. Follow them through, even if it does mean diving into the fountain. But if you put that Lotus Orb onto the Gyrocopter like they did there, Gyro can turn and fight. That's what the hero's made for. He wants to stand his ground, get the flat cannon damage out, and Rocket Barrage with the cooldown, which he was actually allowed to do there, because Swift Ending hasn't really had the chance to shine this game.
Yeah, certainly not. He really needs to finish up that MKB, though, if they're going to put that much pressure on him to essentially carry this game with BKB and Lotus Orb being placed on him. He's got to be able to finish off his big damage item. Maybe then they can win the fight. Still, though, they blow through buybacks, and that was big for Power Rangers. Big win there. The next fight they win, they can potentially end the game straight up because of that. But at the same time, 4C&L are buying time. They're buying time for this Gyrocopter to get bigger and bigger. And maybe, just maybe, the Gyrocopter will be able to out-carry the SF and the Wraith King once he has that MKP. But at the same time, I don't think you're going to want to try and push late as 4C&L. Like, you're going to have, I think, this very small window around 45, 50 minutes where you have control and you have to try and end the game. Otherwise, you're facing Wraith King, who's not the be-all, end-all of carries by any means. But he does have enough farm that he should be a distinct nemesis to the Gyrocopter, always being able to blink, hopefully Abyssal. But also the fact, SF, you know, he actually is a great late-game carry for any mid. You know, it's like Lina and SF, I think, are the most common mids that are picked up that go into the late-game the strongest.
Yeah, and even though Pudge is going to be useful, no matter what the period of the game is, just the fact you can displace, hook, dismember, go through BKBs, he does not have any really great items. He's got four staff. He has no blink. He doesn't have an Aghanim scepter or a glimmer cape or boots of travel. He's quite limited in what he can do. It is all down to his hooks. And then if you miss the hook, that's an opening.
Yeah.
No, that's a few seconds there where Power Rangers can say, okay, well, they can't drag us back. They can't solo down one target and kill him off. We've got the numbers advantage. We can jump forward. We've got blink on the dark side. We can do whatever the hell we want.
Yeah.
But can they go up and defend this tier 3 at top? Because Pycat is really pushing this in quite heavily.
Yeah, he's actually doing a great job. He's going to force back the rotation of the Rubik to start things off. Gets a steal. Dragon Slave it is. What happens when you Lotus Orb? Spell steal?
What happens when you Lotus Orb spell steal?
I'm sure nothing, right?
There was a bug where you could give 5 Meepos Ravage with that. Not sure if you saw that, but no. You could put Lotus Orb onto the Meepos and then have spell steal take. I can't remember how it worked, but spell steal stole the Ravage and gave it to the Meepos.
EGM going to be brought back by Sexy Bambo. Digiraw pushes forward. He does have that Scotty to start things off with the slow, but everyone will manage to get out. MKB finished. But it's still going to be Scotty and Aegis now for Digiraw.
But I don't think it does anything. It's not like it's gonna give the enemy hero telekinesis or fate bolt or something like that.
Yeah.
It'd be pretty cool if it did though.
Cheshire Cat's gonna be able to do quite a large amount of work, I think, with this Blink Dagger.
They don't have the mech on the Shadow Fiend anymore though.
Yeah. Time to go for those Guardian Greaves!
Yeah.
Work towards the 45-minute Greaves. Another great block off. Once again, EGM always setting things up. Pull back here. Jackal continues to push forward, though he is a little bit distance. Nice Fisher steal. That's going to be big. Ranged Rax will easily be going down. Jackal backs himself up. Doesn't want to give away that reincarnation just yet. Still has the cheese. He'll be able to lifesteal off of some of these creeps.
And then he's got Omelette BKB as well. He's not really under too much threat here. You can still go in and initiate with a third HP Wraith King. It's not that big a deal.
Jackal really wants to go on EGM. No, he's going to go on Swift Ending now. We'll be able to jump him. EGM looking to stop this with the Fissure. Digiraw will blink forward, pop the BKB ultimate, and get the damage reduction out. That should allow them to take this melee Rax uninhibited. But EGM's going to jump in. Fissure gets laid out. Jackal immediately turns on EGM. Will be able to pop him. No Echo Slam for this fight. Now Fissure onto Pycat with the control of the telekinesis. They should be able to pick up this kill. Jackal gets pulled back, but it's still going to be a reincarnation that ends up slowing down everyone. Digiraw battling out with Pycat and Swift Ending. You'll have to be able to dodge. Jackal comes back down, though, with a BKB. Will be able to finish off Pycat, it looks like. No, a Fiend's Grip. Pycat just almost gets out of Janata. Hit comes out from J4, able to finish things off. Jackal now going in even deeper, but a hook back inside the fountain. He's got to be careful. Digiraw has now come back. They all start retreating J4? Back to finish off these goddamn melee racks, which is finally going to die.
It's like I said, regardless of whether you have to dive into fountain, regardless if you lose your tier 3 mid, and maybe even tier 3 at top as the range creeping catapult are actually going away at it, you still get the objectives you wanted. You got the racks at bot.
Nice hook. Digiraw going to be pulled back in. Call down. Looking to slow down Arcade Power Rangers from being able to finish off this game. Still need another 10 seconds for the Lina, who does not want to buy back. Same goes with the Bane. Echo Slam gets laid in. Fissure, they desperately need more damage. They will have it. Enough to finish off Digiraw. Big Nub goes down as well. EGM found his opening. Power Rangers. I cannot believe the number of times that they have been stalled out, and I swear if they lose a building here, I will be shocked.
Okay, they don't. J4's there. He's going to tank through.
He'll draw all the aggro off, but still, like, I am at a loss. 4C&L are losing these fights, but they're also somehow winning the secondary fights with less heroes. Right? Like, they come back, say, like, the Roshan fight. Like, or not the Roshan fight, but, like, when they defended that bottom lane, they lose the initial fight, but because of the hooks that were present and them going back in, they're actually able to finish things off, and this melee Rax will end up going down. A Rax for a Rax exchange.
I can't remember who was talking about this around TI4. I think it might be an AUI. Talking about the sort of cycles of team fights and cycles of spells being used, The Radiant have Vacuum Wall, Reincarnation, Requiem.
Yeah.
They've got obviously telekinesis and track and things like that. But those big spells they've got there to win themselves team fights, long cooldowns, or relatively long cooldowns.
Mm-hmm.
4C&L, they've got Hook, Light Striker, Ray Fisher, they've got all these sort of smaller spells where they can actually come back into a fight after maybe they've lost the first wave. So even if they do get bullied for the first 30 seconds in a team fight, that first tidal wave, the first big hit here from Power Rangers, it can be kind of held off. And if you've got the respawn times, if you've got the buybacks from 4C&L for, you just know the Power Rangers now, they're angry. And they're a swarm of angry bees. They've lost the racks when they really shouldn't have.
Yeah.
They want to go back towards middle lane. They want to try and get revenge. So you know that big hit's coming. If 4C&L all have buybacks, which they don't, Lina's trying to farm it up. Gyro does now, and Earthshaker does as well. They've basically all got them. Bane is going to be the only one without. And Darkseer, buybacks on cooldown. So I mean, this could actually be tipping point. This could be where 4C&L lose the first wave of the team fight. Maybe they get forced to buy back on one or two heroes, turn it back around, but then they get the trade off of Roshan, which or tier three down at bottom lane.
Man, 4C&L, I've just been so impressed how they're able to like keep certain heroes alive, draw. I mean, how many fights did we have around the fountain? Like, this area has seen more action in a Dota 2 game than I think I've ever seen before in my life. Unless it's, like, just straight-up silly stomp, where you have these silly fights going on right outside the fountain. Like, these are legitimately an incredibly close game, and this area has become just this nuclear battlefield where it normally ever shouldn't be, but 4C&L have just managed to always draw the team fight out, force them to come to us, bring them back with the hook, force them to continue to try and finish off that one hero. And next thing you know, Power Rangers are, one hero short. They get another hero picked off on the way out. Then they try and go for more, but there's always something that stops them. EGM has been playing incredibly well with his Fishers and Echo Slams, and Sixy Bambo on the money with the hooks.
That's a satanic on the courier. J4, J4. Oh, they see it, but they don't blink for it. It gets delivered.
So satanic now for the gyrocopter. A secondary life when he needs it most. But at the same time, this is going to be a cost at his actual second life. No buyback for the gyro. Still just needs 1,000 gold for it.
Mr. Bounty Hunter. Where are you heading off to? And Cheshire Cat has another 2,000 gold to spend. He has still not gone for the Greaves, which we're really looking out for. But 4C&L, they hold up in their base. They've got good wave clearing out the creep wave, Dragon Slave Fisher, and that pretty much does it. One more Light Strike Array or a few more right clicks from Lina quells the push. They do have to deal with the super creeps down in bottom lane, while Power Rangers are really shoving this middle lane very hard indeed.
Thing I'm a bit concerned about is it seems like our Lina, the one hero who has a lot of growth potential still on 4C&L, obviously the same can be applied to the gyrocopter, but you always expect him to always be building more. The Lina has kind of stalled out, got that Lotus Orb, has 2,700 gold right now, but has oftentimes been the target of Power Rangers, so hasn't been able to survive through those fights, hasn't been able to pick up some of these kills. Oh, Power Rangers actually want to be able to fight this one Fisher, and Hook will be able to snag Jackal, but do they really want him? He's got the Lotus Orb, will be able to turn around and get the stun. The rest of the team on the 4C&L backup.
Butt-clenching moment. Oh,
yeah, that was
Bane.
So
that Bane. Super fortunate to have teammates like this to get the Fisher, to get the gyrocopter, to literally walk up to the Bane and bodyguard him back towards the base.
They're just playing the late game team fight so well on 4C&L, despite the very distinct disadvantage that they were at just like 10 minutes ago. Like 10,000 gold lead when these first crazy fights started happening, went up to like 12,000, now brought down to 6K. If Lina, though, can survive through this next team fight and it goes relatively well for 4C&L and you can get an Aghanim Scepter.
Wait, are they scouting? Are they scouting Rosh here? What are they up to?
When is Rosh on? The Rosh on timers, it's bugged for you, right?
Long ass time. Everyone's bugged. Like 5 minutes? 1, 2, 3, 4 minutes.
Wait, is that the actual time?
4 minutes until Aegis goes. They took it very recently, right? So they've got cheese on the Shadow Fiend.
I feel like Roshan is soon, and this.
Or did
I
they have
Roshan
cheese on the Wraith King?
Bugged.
Or did they have cheese on the Wraith King and then pass it over to Shadow Fiend? And yeah, maybe you're right. I don't know. I've lost track. There's been like four Roshans. This will be the fourth
one. Like that. Yeah, minute 50. So Roshan is coming in soon. Damn Roshan timer being bugged. Oh my goodness, the vacuum! He doesn't quite catch Sexy Bambo Power Rangers, so we're so close to finding a free pickoff. But as it is, somebody's going to have to go up to this top lane, and it's going to be a very inopportune time. They really think Roshan's going to be happening here quite soon. But somebody has to go up to that top lane and defend this heavy push, especially with no tier 3 tower up. And the moment somebody shows up, you know 4C&L are going to surge forward, look to take Roshan themselves, or look to force a fight.
Yeah, and who do you even send to defend against Alina?
I mean, somebody's got to do it soon. You can't just let the creeps get onto this building.
It's going to be multiple people, though. I think the Doc's here, and now TPing against the Bounty. But look at where 4C&L are.
Yeah, they're actually going for the aggressive play. If they win a fight.
Do they know?
J4, he's been spotted. Oh, the blink away. They missed the fissure. They missed the hook. And J4 managed to survive. What a great pickoff that would have been. To start things off, Yule Scepter, Light Strike range, just your cat, the target here, and they will be able to throw. Whoa, Jesus. The commitment is heavy there. They throw out an Echo Slam, a Laguna Blade. I mean, the Laguna Blade has low cooldown, but they committed the hook as well as the Blink Echo Slam just to be able to finish off that Darkseer, quickly get the kill, and back out with no losses.
I guess they don't know Darkseer doesn't have buybacks. They probably would have taken the timer down. You know, his buyback's coming off cooldown now. But he just bought Boots of Travel.
Yeah.
And being their main high ground defensive hero there with a vacuum wall, I wonder if 4C&L could have actually gone and taken that. Because they've got two lanes pushing in. They've got mid and top, but Roshan is going to be...
Oh, wow. Double damage on the Gyrocopter, too. I think that because of the fact they were like, if we get a pickoff on this core, and we have both the top and middle lane pushing in, there's no way that they can both defend and fight Roshan. Yeah. So either Lina will take that top lane while they come to fight us around Roshan, we'll just buy time, or they're going to defend and we easily get Roche for ourselves. Four man smoke up. As you can see, that top lane is pushing in. They know something is coming. That's why exactly why EGM's going to start scouting it out. This is just him trying to buy time for his team. EGM, Glimmer capes up. Sasuke runs back in to the Roshan pit. They will be able to take Aegis and Cheese here. But is this going to be a bad fight? Fisher on to two. Swift ending. Forced to be able to just turn and fight as best as possible. Will be losing his first life. Hook over the side, but he wanted to be able to get the Gyrocopter. And that, unfortunately, is not going to be happening. Our Gyrocopter is going to die a secondary time without much happening here. Wait, nope, Satanic not going to be enough. J4 managed to survive against Pycat, and he will go down as well. Pycat trying to save his Gyrocopter, but I think that was a guaranteed lost fight. There was nothing you can do to help him out. And now, don't tell me, Soxka, he's going to try and get to the side shop here,
keep
buy a
running.
TP and get out.
Oh, three hits. One, two. Did you run? No!
J4, he almost had that shuriken in time. But now they're going to be able to force buybacks. Perhaps a buyback on three. They may hold on to the Earthshaker buyback. 15 seconds, we'll see.
I mean, Jackal just walked straight up to the tier three.
Yeah, he's got an AC. That armlet, he can dish out a lot of damage onto these buildings. That minus armor. And that top lane did manage to survive. Looks like Cheshire Cat pushed it out.
And he's got BOTs.
And no buybacks forced.
Huh.
Much more patient and careful play from Power Rangers than I expected.
I don't, see, this time I don't know why.
The problem, I think, being is that if they pushed uphill and they get caught there, they could potentially just be in, like, a very game-losing position.
Yeah, I guess turn back around on them and they lose, what, two more lanes of racks?
Yeah, they're in a very precarious position right now. J4 runs right in there, and he had the gem too. He dropped the counterwards in order to lay that one out. They're still going to try and fight. Sexy Mambo, double force out to the side. Sasuke is going to be the food here. He just throws out the Fiend's Grip to try and slow down Dichira. Same thing the cooldown does. Pick off for a pick off. And did they recover the gem?
Earthshaker has it, but I'm wondering if Bane had one as well.
Yeah, they recovered it. So the Bane picked up the Bounty Hunter's gem that was dropped. So,
okay.
Look at Pycat.
Split pushing away.
You should know that it's time to get out, though. And he has that Aghanim Scepter coming in, but we're getting to that point in the game where you want to get that next late game item, but buybacks are so costly. As what do you got? He's only got 2K surplus. So he still needs another like 2,100 gold before he can buy Aghanim Scepter and still have.
Do you still go Axe this late in the game?
I mean, I think so. The pure damage is still really valuable, but maybe not. Maybe he opts for something else, like, I don't know, Shiva's?
Shiva's Hex, maybe?
Yeah, I think Shiva's would be okay in slowing down the Wraith King, and I think you do need some sort of armor upgrade, but Scythe of Ice wouldn't be bad, but he doesn't have a Blink Dagger to couple with it.
Or you start thinking about the sort of possibilities of the rat game, where maybe a Desolator, Boots of Travel, things like that could actually work out in your favor.
Yeah, honestly, they could, with the way the Bycat's already been split-pushing so heavily and keeping that top lane pushed in. He can potentially get the pick off on the one hero that goes for the defense and maybe take the building.
But that's like long shot territory.
Yeah, that's very much all in on a split push rather than even trying to win the fight. That would be essentially giving
gyro.
Up. Gyro, don't tell me. Oh, he gets off the BKB, but he's slowed down by the Scotty. He's surrounded. He will go down here. And he knows how bad that was. He's dead for 90 seconds. There's just no way they can fight this one without him.
Like, do the two guys at the top have to just commit for this?
Yeah, they have to go straight for the throne, and that's exactly what Power Rangers are going to do. They're going to bring back Sasuke, easily get that kill. They're just trying to buy as much time as possible on the side of 4C&L for the top lane push to be good, but Sexy Bamboo, he just takes a small amount of time for Dichiron to be able to focus him down. Jump forward, Jackal actually already getting another one. Hookshot back in, trying to control these heroes, but Power Rangers sticking together as much as possible. Jackal focusing down that tier 4 tower. And it looks like this could be it. Jackal has still the reincarnation to be able to fight this one out. 4C&L, I think, are just hoping to be able to bring the heroes back inside the fountain to be able to fight it out. But the throne is being beat on by the SF. They're going to leave Jackal on the front lines. Easily takes out the Pudge while the SF, bit by bit, chunks down the throne. Nice vacuum in, but it's all over. They can't even get to the SF in time to be able to stop this one. Pycat just lifts out as much damage as possible. EGM even gets a good Echo Slam, but it really does not matter one bit.
Power Rangers, their aggression really paid off this game. But laning phase, the Wraith King got nothing whatsoever. That Earthshaker Pudge worked out a hell of a lot. For 4C&L, it's just unfortunate for them that they allowed the Wraith King a little bit more time than maybe he should have. And Shadow Fiend's item build, I thought it was a little bit wonky at first, going Sanj back into mech and the Darkseer going into that pipe. But it allowed them to sustain through things like the Echo Slam, allowed them to push up onto high ground very early on, and Gyrocopter cooldown really didn't do that much.
Yeah, and the Desolator wasn't a bad call. That's when Pycat picked up at the tail end.
It's like the last edge resort, last resort item that you kind of pick up on the laner in those situations.
So that brings a close to our series. Goes 1-1 in this two-game series. We are going to be taking a very, very short break. Our next match is going to be starting at 22:30. So please stick around. We'll have Monkey Business versus 4C&L.